The turnout for this press conference reflects the importance of this project and the magnitude of the traffic impacts that the department, its sister transportation agencies, and local municipalities have planned so hard to minimize. For those citizens of Jersey City, when there are complaints and you're really angry about the traffic or anything else, don't blame Mayor Fulop. Blame the Department of Transportation, because we are responsible for this project. Anything that happens to make it better, please give the mayor and his administration the credit. The buck stops with us at the DOT. But with respect to the bridge, almost 82 years ago, the engineering marvel that looms in the distance behind us was open to traffic, creating a new transportation link for motor vehicles between New York City and New Jersey and points west. It was known by several names, including the first superhighway, the Meadowlands Viaduct, the Diagonal Highway, and the High-Level Viaduct, before it was named the Pulaski Skyway. It stretches for 3.5 miles between Newark and Jersey City, high above the Meadowlands in Kearney, and over two rivers, the Passaic and Hackensack Rivers. It fed motor vehicles to the mouth of what was then the 5-year-old Holland Tunnel. In the 1920s and 30s, constituted a great era for building in this country, and particularly in this region, infrastructure that was needed to accommodate the newest modes of transportation, being cars, buses, and trucks. If you think about how long ago all this infrastructure was built, the Holland Tunnel was opened in 1927, the George Washington Bridge opened up in 31, the Pulaski Skyway in 32, will be almost 82 years old, and the Lincoln Tunnel was opened in 1937. It carries 74,000 vehicles on any given day, including 40,000 motor vehicles in the northbound direction toward Jersey City, Hudson County, and New York destinations daily. What has diminished its structural integrity? 82 years of pounding traffic, road salt, and suboptimal drainage systems have taken a huge toll on all components of the bridge, and that's why we're here today. We launched an 8-year, $1 billion-plus rehabilitation program back in 2012, and the planning for most of this was back in 2005. And we now have reached a point where we're ready to tear off 14 lane miles of the original bridge deck, more than 1 million square feet, and install new, brand new, 21st century deck consisting of high-strength, prefabricated concrete panels with new steel floor beams that support the bridge, and stringers where needed to support the deck. The original deck is 16 inches in some areas. The new deck will be 8 inches thick, lightening the dead load of the bridge by 27%. So we're giving this bridge a real diet. We're putting it on a real diet. That, coupled with the fact that no trucks are allowed on it, has made it structurally sound. It will continue to keep it structurally sound for at least the next 75 years. Work will continue to repair or replace components of the superstructure. The superstructure is basically all the black steel that you can see, and the substructure, which is basically any of the piers or anything under the ground or the piers leading up to the steel, into the year 2020. But it's the next 2 years that are the most important and which will have the most impact on traffic. If we don't do this now, we literally might wake up one morning and find ourselves facing an emergency closure of the entire bridge. In fact, we have had some emergency closures in the last couple of years. In report card terms, as the engineers like to say sometimes, this bridge is a D- and about to become an F, and an F is failure. Engineers have their own way of describing the bridge, using terms like condition and sufficiency rating. The Skyway superstructure, all of the steel is in poor condition. You have excellent, good, fair, poor, and failure, pretty much. This is in poor. The deck of the roadway is in poor condition. The substructure, everything below the deck is rated as fair. Chief among the Skyway's features that it led to its functional obsolete designation is a lack of shoulders. Shoulders provide space for emergency vehicles to cut through the traffic, or space for disabled vehicles to get out of the way and allow other traffic to flow. Due to the design of the Skyway, we can't widen it, and it will remain a bridge that offers just two travel lanes in each direction with no shoulders. However, we can make functional improvements, and we will where we can. For instance, as the Broadway ramp where motorists merge onto the Skyway southbound lanes, the geometry will be improved to provide more acceleration distance and better sight lines for safe merging. One of the reasons why trucks were banned back in 1934 was the ramps coming off those exits where trucks had numerous accidents at the time. The project also includes new lighting along the entire length of the structure and new railings that will meet modern crash and safety standards. And speaking of railings, those balustrades that are out there, they're rotted as well. So it's not just the deck. The railings and some of the structural members underneath that support the deck that are an integral part of this this bridge have to be replaced. In less than a year from now, the southbound traffic that will continue to flow over the sky will be shifted to the new northbound lanes, and the construction crews will switch to the southbound side to start the process of replacing the deck on that side of the structure. They will work around the clock 7 days a week to finish the job, both sides of the Skyway in 2 years. And we had broken this out in two contracts. We had contract three, which was for the northbound side, and some other work in contract four, which was the southbound side. And CCA, which is already mobilized, was successful in getting contract four, which was great news for us at the DOT, because we've got the same contractor already in place, and they're already talking to the DOT staff to see if there's, now that they've got both contracts, is there anything that can be done to take 2 years off the time frame? I'm not promising. I'd rather under-promise and over-deliver, but they're already talking about it. So it's not like, you know, we say, okay, 2 years and we're fine. If we can get this done in anything less than 2 years, I guarantee you we will. We got the best engineers and we got one of the best contracting companies there are doing this work.
So I'll start by saying that when I first took office on July 1st last year, one of the things that I looked into initially was the impact of the Pulaski, if we could explore alternative plans other than what has been proposed. And when you understand all the nuances that the commissioner just went through, you really realize that this is really the only option for the entire region. We're lucky that Commissioner Simpson has lived in Jersey City before, so he understands the impact. But like any other plan, this has to be flexible. And everything that we've done up till now has stressed flexibility, knowing that we're not going to get it right on day one, and that we're going to try and get it right through the first 2 weeks so that we can move forward through the rest of the year. I am 100% confident that we will figure it out. Whenever there has been issues like this, you've seen residents and drivers and government work together to solve those situations. Best example is in the days after 9/11, when they shut down most of the tunnels and bridges for Lower Manhattan, and people said similar things. What will be the impact and access points into Manhattan be? And people figured it out. So we recognize that there will be stress in the near term, but we do recognize that there will be some progress and flexibility in our part. Jersey City has done several things that we think are really important. We have added 55 police officers paid for by the DOT. That is several million dollars at their expense that's going to be during rush hour. And the goal of that is to pull traffic through intersections in an expedient manner. We've also changed left turn options through our major thoroughfares. If there's two lanes moving through them, we're limiting left turn options only on major streets. So that way the two lanes can continue to go through Jersey City and flow properly. You know, we're going to be monitoring it. Our OEM is going to be operational. We're likely to declare a state of emergency for the city to give ourselves flexibility for the first 2 weeks in order to change personnel shifts, in order to move people around without going through an entire legislative process, recognizing that that's important. And we're looking forward to continually working with the DOT commissioner here and figuring out the solution for Jersey City. I would stress again what he said earlier, the importance of mass transportation. And the biggest concern I have is that residents don't realize yet the impact that it'll have. The example is that we've had several town hall meetings here in Jersey City, and the attendance has been less than we would have hoped. And the reason being, I think that people aren't appreciating yet what the impact will be to them till Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday of next week. And at that point, we're going to have to adjust and adapt like we're planning on it.
Well, what we're looking at is, this is the floor deck. We've got cars riding above us. We're under a section of the Pulaski Skyway. And this piece of steel here, about a year ago, was encased in concrete. Back in 1932, when they built the bridges, they encased the steel in concrete, figuring it would give it a longer life. But we're also at an area where there's a joint in the highway. It's to allow for expansion and contraction. And over the years, since 1932, water has gotten in here, salt has gotten in here, and what you're looking at is a piece of steel, this is an I-beam, that is corroded to the point where it looks like a piece of Swiss cheese. Now, as an old friend of mine once said, you don't have to be an engineer to determine that I-beams should not look like this. So the structural integrity of this beam that holds this section of the highway has been compromised. Is it safe? Yes, it's safe because we put temporary beams in place. We've got temporary vertical and horizontal supports that is supporting the weight of this bridge. So when people say, well, why are you closing the skyway? You've got to replace this steel. This job, and you've got a 3.5 miles, 120 spans, and you've got multiple areas where you've got steel that's been compromised in one form or another. It could be the flange area, which is the top of an I-beam, or in a very bad case like this, the entire I-beam has to come out. Additionally, you've got stringers. They're also steel that run in the same direction of the traffic in many places that have to be replaced. So the concrete deck, which is 18 inches thick, has to come off first. Then before you put the new deck down, which is only 6 inches and a lot lighter and a lot stronger than they did it in 1932, you've got to replace the steel. So the only way to get that down is to close the bridge. And we're closing half the bridge. As you know, we're closing the bridge traffic going into Manhattan. So in 12 months, you're going to have a brand new highway, 2 lanes, not 4, that the traffic will be moved onto that brand new highway while we do the other side of the bridge. So in 2 years, while folks in Jersey City and the surrounding region are going to suffer a lot of pain, we're going to give you back a 75-year bridge. The only way that we can do it is this way. We're on an accelerated, this is an accelerated bridge design and build schedule for this bridge. You can't do it any faster. If we could do it any faster, we would. We understand the pain that everybody's going to suffer, but we've been working really closely with Jersey City and Kearny, particularly Jersey City, that's going to bear the brunt of it. We put a task force together under Mayor Fulop and myself. We meet weekly. This can't stand. We've got to do it. We can't kick the can down the road and leave it for the next administration. We have to do it now. This bridge is rated, in my opinion, a D minus. We let it go any longer, it's going to be an F. F, we close the bridge. We don't want to close the bridge. What we don't want is we don't want this bridge to be a tourist attraction that people look at from afar and they say, you know, one day cars would travel on that bridge. So this is it's the biggest project we have in the state. It's $1.2 billion. And I don't even know if you've got a project like this any round in the country where we're rebuilding a bridge in place, and that's what we're doing here.